The following podcast is brought to you by the Jonas Podcasting Network, found exclusively at wrestlingwithjonas.com.
Welcome to the latest edition of the SWN podcast. I am your host, as always, Billy. And I am joined on this edition with one half of Casino Brutal. It is Mikey Devine. Welcome to the show.
Hi, Billy. Thanks for having me, mate. Pleasure.
I'm excited for this one. Just because I was looking through some of your matches and I've got a lot of compliments for your team. So we'll get to that later on. But we'll start with the same boring question. Mm-hmm. Everyone gets it. How'd you get into pro wrestling? What was the moment that got you hooked?
Well, I've always wanted to be a wrestler ever since I was kind of a wee boy. When I got to the age of about 8 or 9, my mum and dad had took me to a kind of amateur wrestling class just because I wanted to be a wrestler. And obviously, back then, we didn't know of any professional wrestling sort of classes that and sort of training schools that were about at that time. So I'd done that for a few years, and then I kind of fell away from it, kind of my teens and stuff. And then it wasn't until I was about 20, I'd seen a poster for a show, and I'd said to my friends, "Do you want to go to it?" And we went to it a couple of weeks later, and I decided that, you know what, I'm 20 odd, I'd be as well giving it a bash now, and because if I didn't, I would have just regretted it, and that's how it started, really.
So you said you always wanted to be a wrestler. What was your first memory of it then? Who was on the screen, and who was your favourites?
When I was a young boy, I always loved Undertaker, obviously for the character and just the aura of watching him on screen. Just as I got older, obviously I idolised Shawn Michaels. I wanted to always be like him, like just the way, obviously he's the kind of wrestler that he is. Rob Van Dam and Jeff Hardy, we kind of went on a wee bit of there was a bit of a trend going. Rob Van Dam, Shawn Michaels.
It seems to be not an episode goes by when it's someone around about my age, because you're just like maybe a year or two younger than I am, and Jeff Hardy always seems to come up. He's just cool.
Obviously because of the things he's done and stuff like that, and all the kind of high risk moves kind of pulls you in. Shawn Michaels, just kind of the wrestler that he was, always overcoming the odds and stuff like that, and coming back from his injury and stuff like that, just, you know, he stuck with me as my favourite growing up. As a young boy, obviously, it was The Undertaker that initially got me hooked, but then as time went on and stuff like that, obviously he likes the Stone Cold and Rock and that, they obviously were up there as well, but I think Shawn Michaels and The Undertaker were the two that kind of got me hooked.
And then you get your old random favourites, like for me it was Too Cool. I love Too Cool and what have you, and like Steve Blackman as well, hardcore Steve Blackman, and all that kind of stuff. It was Shawn Michaels being a favourite, I'm guessing you started watching, late 90s, early 2000s?
Yeah, late 90s, early 2000s. I was born in 93, so obviously seven or eight was when I really started properly watching wrestling, being able to stay up. My dad let me stay up late and watch it and stuff like that. My mum was never too happy about it, but I was allowed. Used to love when I was in high school, well, primary school, going into high school and stuff like that, when all the pay-per-views were in Sky Box Office. My mum and dad would always rent it for me when it was £15 back then. And I used to sit in school on the Monday, absolutely buzzing to go home and watch the pay-per-view, because I was never allowed to stay up when it was going on to a school day. So I was always good growing up.
So we've just been either just in or just missed this the Channel 4 era of the four shows that they did, or what have you. That was amazing.
It was Sky Sports for me. It was always every Sunday night. Mom and dad rent it for me and say, right, it'll be ready for you. They taped it on a video, and I got to watch it on the Monday after school, which was good.
I think this is the first time I've ever spoken to someone who actually did that, because everyone else seemed to have, or everyone that's brought this up always seems to know a guy or know a friend that did all the taping. Because that was me. I would always have to wait until Tuesday to see a pay-per-view, because my mate would record it and then come to school. He'd watch it Monday night, come to school Tuesday, like slide the tape to me like some sort of covert mission, because, you know, wrestling wasn't cool. So I had to just slide it to him when no one was looking, and then I'd go home, watch it, and take it back to him on the Thursday. So it was a weird time. You don't get that fun nowadays. Nowadays it's just like at your fingertips, and I could give me 5 minutes, I could watch any pay-per-view ever, and it's just it's not as fun.
It was the box sets as well, a yearly box set. You got, had every pay-per-view on a DVD, a big always. It was good times, but now like after a pay-per-view, you wake up on the Monday and you see all the highlights on Twitter and Instagram and all that. So again, it's not ruined it, but it's ruined the being buzzing all day on the Monday to go home and watch it, or staying up on the Sunday. What are you?
Then you become an adult, and now because this is my office, this is my work office. I work from home because of COVID, so now I can just watch it live and come in looking like absolute crap. So it's fantastic, but it's definitely evolved over time. Where I would be sitting at the bus stop waiting for this VHS tape, which doesn't sound creepy at all when you put it out of context. And now nowadays I'm just like tap. Oh, there it is. There's the show. And when you say you can see the highlights, I'm of that opinion now. If I don't see the pay-per-view live, I don't see it, because I see all the bits afterwards. I'm like, what's the point? I mean, spending 3 hours watching this when all the cool bits are already on social media now.
The surprises are kind of ruined as well.
Absolutely. I couldn't imagine watching something like Royal Rumble 2020 and not watching it live, and then seeing Twitter the next morning saying Edge is back and Drew's won, and I would be like, oh well, there's no point watching then. That's all the cool stuff done. So you said you didn't know about any wrestling. So you said you went to that first show with your mates. Did you go to any like the tribute shows, the WWE shows when you were younger? Because your parents were quite fine for kind of encouraging watching wrestling. Encouraging.
I got took to a tribute show. I remember one of them American tribute ones where it was like knockoff Undertakers, knockoff Canes and Rocks and stuff like that. I remember my dad taking me to one of them when I was a wee boy anyway, and it was when I just started kind of watching wrestling, and the show was, from what I can remember, beat all those years, the show was amazing, and like the wrestlers on it were class, but there was one that was obviously a tribute to The Undertaker, and he just came out, and at that time that was when he was my favourite, because it was him that initially hooked me. And I was like, Dad, it's The Undertaker, and I'm shaking him, and he's like, go and tap him. I've ran up, and all the other children have all ran up, and everyone's patting him on the back as he's walking to the ring, and he's turned and he's looked at me, and I'm like, ah, run back to the dad's leg. He's scary. So they ones were good. I went to a WWE show as well when I was in primary school. I think it was primary 4, primary 5. The most over person on that show was the person that was sweeping the ring between all the hardcore matches and stuff like that. That's what I remember from it. I remember I was sitting in my seat, my dad's went away to get food, and their favourite were Triple H and Stone Cold and stuff like that. And he's went down to get hot dogs and burgers and stuff like that. And it was at the interval just before the second half kicked off. Second half kicked off and Stone Cold music hit. And he was at the back of the queue. And as soon as his music hit, the line cleared. And he was like, yes, result. Straight up and got food. So he was happy with that. I'd also, a few years ago, I had won a competition on the Iron Brew Facebook page. to get tickets to go see the WWE show. It was 2019, I think it was, when they were over. And I went to win two tickets, and it was in like the boxes at Hydro. Me and the missus went. It was brilliant. It's just good to go see WWE shows, I think. It's a kind of spectacle. And it was, the Shield were wrestling. It was one of the last kind of times when the Shield were on. So it was good. It was good to see that.
That's cool. I mean, first one I went to 2006. So I missed all this cool stuff. I got to see Shawn Michaels, so I got DX against Rated RKO. And it's weird when you see these shows and you think, when you go to other shows like UK Indies, and they're great. They're amazing. And then when you see the WWE, you just go, wow, this is, I mean, it's not inherently different. It's just bigger guys. Because, I mean, seeing the likes of, one year I got to see Undertaker, I got to see Great Khali. And I don't think anything prepares you for the size of Great Khali. Because when you see him, I was 3 rows back, and I was like going, oh my God, that's not human. That shouldn't be. That's too tall. That's too tall. Uh-huh. And see these guys. And and then, last one I went to was that came out of my memories actually recently. It was about 3 or 4 years ago. It was the AJ Styles Dean Ambrose main event. I was like, yeah, that was worth going to just for that. And like I said, the most over guy there was Randy Orton, who did nothing. He literally did an RKO, and that was it. Easiest payday of his life, I'm guessing. He just every time he came in, everyone shouted RKO, and he just tagged out because he was a heel. Amazing! I was watching it, just going, oh, I don't know why that's worth all my money, but that's just worth all the money just to watch him just play this crowd like puppets, just going, you will chant for me. No, I'm not going to do the thing you want. So you saw the, you did some amateur wrestling, then how did you, so this is your kind of, you don't know if you can do some, you don't know if you can go do pro wrestling, but at least you're going to do something wrestling related, so you do amateur. Mm-hmm. How was that? How did you find that as a thing, where you attempted stun folk, or
it was great? No, it was great. I loved it. Obviously, it helped me a wee bit once I came into professional wrestling, stuff like that. But I did love it. I still have my wrestling boots that I trained in then, back then, like now, and I still use the same boots. Robbie will tell you the exact same. I've had these white ASICS boots since I was doing it at my amateur wrestling, and I still use them for training now for wrestling. I don't know how they've managed to last this long, but they have.
So amateur, when you're getting into that, obviously, as someone growing up watching it, are you thinking, oh, Kurt Angle, this will be, I've got this, I don't know how to do this. I've watched Kurt Angle wrestle enough times to get the basics, or was it just a whole new world of rules and regulations that you weren't prepared for?
Oh, it's a whole different kind of world. Like, it's very, very strict. Like, when you're wrestling stuff like that, like, certain ways you're not allowed. Obviously, I don't know how to describe it. Like,
obviously, things like pressure points you're not allowed to go at and stuff like that.
Uh huh. And every match you wrestle and. Kind of amateur wrestling. Well, it was when I did. You always had to keep a hanky on you in case you bled. There was a blood anywhere. As it's very like right in the middle, kind of strict. It was good. The training was hard to begin with, and it got easier over time. And as it did help me when I first came to start professional wrestling.
Absolutely. So it also helps if you're going through a strict training program, wrestling, I suppose, it can be strict as well, but at least you've got discipline for it, I suppose, that you're there to learn, so you're going to learn, and all that kind of stuff. Do you remember who was on your first actual like Scottish indie show that you went to see? Not the tribute one, but the actual show that you got the poster for, and that spurred you into trying to do it yourself?
I think the DCT was on it. Jack Jester was on it. Obviously, it was only 5 years ago. Five years ago, so like kind of the faces you know nowadays.
Well, Jess is a good one to bring up then, because it was a GPWA you went to straight away, or did you try in our school first before you went GPWA?
It was GPWA.
So when you go in, then you've seen Jack Chester. She's at the time, depending on if it was a family show, either way, scary on either show, it doesn't matter if it's a family show or an ICW one. So you come in, that's your first day, you get to see Chester, BT Gunn, Lionheart, Red Lightning, whoever else was there. Going in and seeing all these guys, I mean, these are, in terms of Scottish wrestling anyway, they're big guys. So was there any intimidation as soon as you walked in and thought, this is different?
I was nervous on my first day. Everybody's nervous on the first day because they don't know what to kind of expect. I was a wee bit nervous, but you get over it quite quickly, I think. Because obviously everyone's welcoming. Obviously you're there to learn. They're teaching you. Obviously treat everyone with respect and stuff like that. So obviously go okay for you. To answer your question, it was quite nerve wracking going there for the first time.
It's one of those things as well it probably wouldn't have been you at the time, but GPWA were one of the main ones to come in and start doing induction like 8 weeks, and then you move on to the next one. A lot of other places would have just been pay your money and keep coming each week, whether you're good or not. We'll still take your money, or we'll just keep you training forever until you give up, kind of thing. So this 8 weeks, again, you said you had the strict background of doing amateur wrestling, so you knew you had that's the block you have to prove, to impress, to get what you need to do. Having a bit of a wrestling background, and like I say, it did help. Did you find it prepared you for things like bumps as well, for like obviously getting thrown about in amateur wrestling?
I wouldn't say obviously for the bumps and stuff like that. Being the amateur wrestling probably didn't really prepare me for that, but the stuff like rolls and stuff like that, and kind of moving about, certainly that did help with that. But I would say the amateur, like fundamental side, other than bumps, it definitely did help.
Yeah, so I mean, as bumps, as you were prepared for landing on your back,
yeah, well,
and things like that. It wasn't too much of a shock to the system, even though in amateur wrestling you tried to avoid it as much as possible, I suppose. Was it just mats that you started off with, and was a lot of cardio and basic fundamentals, or how long was it before you got the dreaded ropes and figuring out how not to burn yourself running against them?
I started off with the kind of fundamentals and rules and stuff like that. The ropes, they came shortly after, but I said, like, they teach you, you're obviously taught how to run them, and then it's just go. I can't really explain it. Like, with stuff like bumps and that, it's just kind of, you learn how to do them, and you just do them. And kind of, you just, if it hurts, you just kind of have to deal with it. The ropes, obviously, it's a bit of a shock when you hit them for so long, and then you wake up the next morning and you look at your back and it's all bruised. That's probably the shock you get off them. But
it's one of those where you go, right, maybe I'll wrestle in a t-shirt forever and I'll avoid that situation. Just seeing all these marks and bruises on people's backs, and I've always said I'm not interested in being a wrestler, because no, but every time I see stuff like that, I'm just like, yeah, I'm quite happy with my decision here. I'll sit at one end of Zoom and just speak to you instead of doing it. That's fine by me. Every so often I think, oh, maybe if I train a little bit, I could do a spot and something that would be amazing for me, and I'll retire. But nah, every time I see you guys wrestle, anyone wrestle, I'm just like, no, it's okay, isn't it? If it happens, it'd be great. But no, I'm not going to put myself out too much for it. So we're at the training stage. Is there anything you particularly struggled with at all when it came to training, or you kind of just because you had that strict teaching brain, did you able to pick things up?
The thing that I probably struggle with in wrestling the most, I'll be honest, is promos and stuff like that, like talking. I did struggle with just that. I'm starting to get a wee bit better, but I'd say at the start I was I struggled a lot with that. Obviously, I'm just kind of the backing man. I let Rabu do all the talking because he's good at it, and I'll just smile in the back. Probably as well getting put over the ropes backwards is something that still is like mentally, there's a mental block. Like I have done it, but once I do it a couple of times, I'm fine. And then if I leave it for a while, that mental block comes back and it's like, I can't do that. So it's going to come a point, hopefully, where I can just get put over the ropes backwards anytime and it's fine. But right now, I'm going through this phase where I'm getting put over them backwards and it's, this is fine. And then it'll go a wee while and then I'll be like, no, I'm not doing it.
I mean, some of the best can't do it. Kurt Angle can never do it. He always did that weird, very scary, like sideways thing where he always seems to land his head on the apron. if he can't do it, and he did pretty all right for himself, I think if it doesn't happen, then as long as you still get over safely, that's the most important thing. It's not like I saw a tweet not long ago, maybe a day or two ago, of Kane. He used to exit the ring. He used to exit backwards, and I looked at it, and I still didn't understand the scientific how it happened, but he always
I've seen that video as well. He just does it so effortlessly.
That's the dream. And if we get to that, then going over the ropes will be easy. So you did mention the promos. We'll get on stuff like that in a bit. So your actual debut then, I've got, according to Cage Match, it was September 18th against Leighton Buzzard. But I'm going to guess there was a rumble, a gala of some description beforehand, before you had that match.
My official debut was against Leighton Buzzard. I had a match before that, kind of away from, in front of a crowd, but it wasn't like a paying audience, against Charlie Vice, which I enjoyed, which was good. Obviously, again, that was nerve-wracking. I didn't find out until quite, it was like the day before. And I obviously, if it was my debut, I was kind of like, I don't even think I'm ready. So the panic mode comes in, but I get through it and I enjoyed it. I'd like to say Charlie enjoyed it as well. It was good and it kind of set me up mentally for my official debut when I wrestled Leighton.
That's the thing, I suppose. I've learned from speaking to a lot of folk from GPWA that the coaches are very in tune with how you guys handle things. If they think that you're going to get too nervous, they'll tell you pretty much the day before it's going to happen, so you don't have time to kind of think about it. Or if you're a guy that needs to prepare a lot, they'll tell you about a month in advance. They seem to be very in tune with their students and how they work and what they need to do to get you to the best point you could be to get onto a debut show, which is always good to hear that they are so invested. There always seems to be like one coach takes a vested interest in a particular group of students, and it's always quite nice. It's always quite nice when you consider seeing these guys like Jester, terrifying in the ring, and then you hear he's just such a lovely guy, killing any aura afterwards. That he's all scary in the ring, and you hear, oh, but he's really nice. Before we get to proper your debut then, who else was in your class then? Do you know, is anyone that's still going about that was in your initial induction course?
My initial induction was November of 2015. I was there until May 2016, and then I took a year away because my girlfriend was pregnant with her daughter, so I was taking some time away, kind of sort myself out, and I was done the old, I'll be back. Usually quite a lot of people do say that when they leave and don't come back. But I actually stuck to it. And I was like, once my wee girl's here and then I'm ready, I'll come back. So from my initial induction from 2015, Levi is the only one technically still there. because I left and came back. He's the only person left from that induction class, excluding me.
So it seems to have. Just goes to show you, wrestling's not for everyone, whether they think it or not. At least you took that break and you still came for it. So obviously, wrestling's still for you. It's good that you took a break and you're able to seek. I mean, at the end of the day, unless you're getting a contract somewhere down the line, wrestling's not your first priority, even though you'd like it to be, I suppose. So you're able to take time off and get your real life in order before you can go back to doing the pretend stuff, but no, it's real to us. Before you go back to the world of wrestling. So when you came back, did you have to kind of go through the induction process again, or did you kind of pick up where you left off?
No, I was away too long. I wouldn't have expected the coaches to have let me just walk back in, because that would have been a kind of, I don't know, they rubbed people up the wrong way, I'd like to think. So I did that. I went back and I'd done all the inductions again and stuff like that. And it was a kind of different format. It was three stages, but I waited my time. And I wanted to do it. I wanted to come back, so I did. I did the full induction again. Obviously, I needed to get myself up to scratch. Being away that long, obviously, you start to get a bit rusty. Ring rust is a real thing.
So what did you find? Yeah, so I suppose when you've done it for that long and then you've taken that big break, and like you said, with you going over the ropes backwards, that takes a little bit of time to get going. Was it a couple of weeks of just finding your footing again, and then you were just back to where you were,
I would say so. There was some things, obviously, I needed fine tuning, but we got there in the end. And that's me. I've been fully back now since 2016.
So proper debut then, 2018, Leighton Buzzard, who is an Argyle. I think at this point he was still, was he doing, I don't know, the years have gone all over the place since all this pandemic stuff. But I think he was again doing stuff with ICW at that point. So at that point, it was still being quite a big-ish name to start off with.
Yes.
So what was that like as your debut then?
It was good. It was good to wrestle somebody like Leighton for my first match. It was good in the asylum. I enjoyed it, and I was obviously I was a bit nervous with my previous match with Charlie and stuff like that. So mentally I was kind of, I was still a wee bit nervous, but mentally I was kind of okay. And I knew he'd look after me anyway. Obviously, and me being the person that's debuting, he kind of took the role of taking the lead, really. And we got through the match and stuff like that, and it was good, and the crowd seemed to have enjoyed it, so I'm happy with that.
So when you say that your promos aren't as good as you want them to be, how did you find working with the crowd? I mean, I suppose later at that point, I can't remember whether he would have been the good or bad guy at that point, but he's always very charismatic anyway, regardless.
They can do both.
So when you came out and you had to try and get the crowd, I don't know if you did the classic "come on guys" or if you were the just scowling boy, if you're a face or heel. But
I was just the growl at them. We were the second half opener, so Leighton's went out and the crowds came up for him, and then I've came out and I've just I was happy enough that I came out and I was getting booed straight away. I knew we're starting good. Let's keep it this way. So I was getting the boost, getting what I needed. So I was happy with that. As it went on, I've started to try and kind of interact with the crowd more. Getting there slowly.
Yeah, I mean, it's always more fun to be the bad guy, isn't it? It's far easier to get boos than it is to get people to like you.
Being a bad guy and being bold is the best. Because I don't really need to do anything. They hate me. They hate me already. They hate me. They're sitting and walk out.
don't understand why that. I suppose Baldy is just such a wonderful chant to go with. I don't. Obviously, I don't partake in those chants because I feel like that's kind of. It's like me shouting four eyes at folk. It kind of lessens the impact on it a little bit when I myself am bald. I didn't have glasses, and I'm just going, "Ah, you're bald. Yes, are you?" Fair enough. Yeah, that's okay. Cool. So at least it gives you a little bit of a. Being the bad guy, it gives you that confidence. Just be an arsehole, I suppose. I don't think that counts as a swear word, but yeah, it's my podcast. So at least you get carte blanche just to be a dick the whole time. So it's great. So at that point, there's a little bit of a break. I'm no doubt Cage Match has missed matches because they seem to. And even though I try to sign up and add matches, they just don't seem to want me there. Even though they'll take my results quite happily when I put them up. So I've got Ravy Davy next. So again, another big... You're kind of getting the original first couple classes as your first couple matches to lead you through. And again, I'm now a big character to interact with and means that makes your job a little bit easier.
It's so much easier when you're in the ring with him because the crowd are so... As well as Leighton, like the crowd are so on their side. Regardless of who they're up against, anyway, when you're in the asylum and at a five-pound wrestling show, so it makes my job so much easier.
So Ravy Davy's got a question, which you have noticed. I'm just going to throw it out. I'm going to read it verbatim because, to be honest, I read it and I got a little confused when I was reading it. Can you ask him what happened? Time there was a shoot style wrestling going on in training, and I got tagged in. And Mikey made a big song and dance of being in with me, so the person obliged and tagged him in. Can you ask him about that, please?
Right, I was kind of waiting for this one, right? So this will haunt me forever. Obviously, this was during my first spell with GPWA. We done BT took. It was BT taking a class and he wanted to do a kind of shoot style, making it look more real. And obviously with my amateur background and stuff like that, I was in the ring and I was just in, obviously trying to make a name for myself, and Davey came in. And I thought it would go. But funnily enough, underneath that tracksuit is a very strong boy. And see, when he got me down in an armbar, I, for the life of me, couldn't get out. And it was the way he had me in an armbar, obviously not trying to break my arm, but I didn't want to tap because of the... So I just made things worse for myself in absolute... So he definitely... He got one up on me anyway. And I said that will probably haunt me for the rest of my days because he does love to bring it up. But It's all on the banner and stuff like that. So I don't mind that. Obviously, it was on me. I thought I had him and I didn't. I really didn't.
In my head, I've got you, Kurt Angle, him, Daniel Peter, and
I'm just getting absolutely well. Hi, it is what it is.
So it was that the first and last time you got a bit. You showed your confidence and. to say next time just to humbly just tap folk out instead.
And he hated me if I didn't answer the question for him. So there you are, Davey. I hope you're happy.
Go through the rest of your match. 2019 you seem to get again a lot of guys that are from the first couple of classes of GPWA, but of course, just as you were getting started, Lionheart passed away, which would have been June 2019. So I don't know how much of his coaching would have went into your overall training. But you made an appearance in PCW a couple of days afterwards, wherever it was, they did a tribute thing. So what was it like first interacting with Lionheart and then getting to see that kind of celebration of him down in Preston?
Obviously, I've got to know Lionheart quite well through my training and stuff like that. And it was always great to me. And when we'd went down for the PCW tribute show. It just showed, like, just kind of the crowd and his fellow peers and stuff like that. It just showed how loved he was down south. Just as much, he was just as loved down there as he was up in Scotland, which was, it was good to see.
So I don't want to like labour on it. It's just because it is a big part of pretty much anyone in GPWA's history that got to interact with them. And I always hear, I hear so many things of Lionheart that they're always ends with, that was just Adrian, that was just Lionheart, as this big, larger than life character. And I do mention it in other podcasts, but one only time I ever had a chance to meet him, I didn't, because he just had the star aura so much. I was like, he doesn't want to speak to me. It's fine. And now I'm sitting here just going, wish I did. But, you know, it is what it is, as you said about other things. But no, so yeah, they're definitely someone who's left an imprint on a lot of guys in GPWA.
He definitely had a positive impact on me and my training. And as I said, he was always great with me. So,
So along with that, in 2019, I also got note of a match outside of GPWA at Reckless Intent. So, how did that end up coming about? Because it's, of course, still in your first, just about in your first year of proper in-ring stuff, and now you're popping up in Reckless Intent.
I'd went to Chip Cullen seminar at Reckless, and after that, they were having a Sunday Slam show that night at the Reckless Training School. And after the seminar, I was told, do you want to hang about if you've got your gear with you? Obviously, you take your gear with you anyway. Mine's used to just stay in my car. No matter where I was going to work, the gear was in the car. So I was told to stick around. And it was from GPWA that was at the seminar. It was me and Soldato, and the two of us were on that show. I wrestled Freddie Mac, who is one of my best friends outside of wrestling. So it was good for me and him to kind of have a paying audience to see us not glimpse at each other. That was nice for me.
As well, though, is because he is a friend, you're able to be a little bit stiffer than you maybe wanted to. It was because he would give it back just as much as you would. So that must be weird then. I don't know. I think Freddie, if I remember rightly from other interviews, he did a couple months at GPWA. Am I right in thinking that? And he did Reckless Intent. So were you guys training at this
point? No, I had left. He started when I had left. So it was my short spell before I left to get my kind of life in order. And that was when he was there. And then when I came back, he wasn't there. Because of like commitments and that, what commitments and stuff for him. So it was a weird one.
So yeah, ships passing the night, and then you got to batter each other in Livingston, of all places.
That's
it. So I mean, at this point, you would have had a couple shows with the GPWA crowd, which £5 wrestling, you probably got a fairly regular audience. They would have known your character, would have got to know you a little bit more. But when you're coming into a new company with a possibly, I would say, a majority of different crowd. Was that kind of a sink or swim moment for you, character-wise? Or were you able just to learn, take the things you'd already got, and just being the bad guy, and just...
I was lucky enough that when I've walked through the curtain at that show, there's been people that go to GPW shows in the crowd, so they already knew me. And I just kind of, it was one of the ones, I just kind of had to turn it up a wee bit more to get myself hated a wee bit more. Being wrestling in a different company from GPWA, and with Freddie being one of the biggest baby faces at Reckless at the time, again made my job a wee bit easier. And it was good that I got to lay in a bit harder on him to get that little bit more booze out of the crowd.
Has there ever been a time that, because again, like I said, I'm going through these list of matches that I've got for you. Charlie Weiss, again, a big, that was May 19, again, they're a big face character. We'll probably speak about that a little bit more in depth in a minute. The Govan team, you know, it's just, everyone loves them. Luke Cairo and I think it's Paul Huntley. I just wrote down Huntley. I'm assuming it's Paul Huntley.
Aye.
And The Purge as well. So this is February 20 at that point. So you're going in the ring with again, big popular characters. So has there ever been a moment where you've went in, maybe it's not on this list, that you've went in and went, oh, I'm going to have to do a little bit more here to get the reaction I need? Or have you been just lucky at this point where the guys you've been facing are so popular that you can do very little and you can get the maximum hated?
I'd say it's, I was probably lucky. So going in order, when I wrestled Charlie Vice, I think, if I'm correct, that was just before his ICW debut. So his name was out there and stuff like that. He'd already been on multiple shows. We were the opener. I'm bald. things are easy. Luke and Paul, we wrestled them in the opener, me and Rabu. And that was our first official tag match together. We'd done
You're
that.
Both bald.
We're both bald. see the pattern here. We were the opener on that show as well. So again, the crowd were already up, with Luke being such a popular name as well. The Govan team, again, was easy because of how popular they were. And then the Pods as well. The Pods were still ICW Tag Team Champions at that point when me and Rabu wrestled them. That was my last match before lockdown, the first initial lockdown. So, I'm quite happy to say that all my matches, I've thoroughly enjoyed them all.
So we'll get onto the tag team then, with Rabu Romero, of course, initially called the Smash Brothers.
Yes.
Just out of curiosity, because we've mentioned it many times, and as a bald man, I can ask you this as well. How many times were you chanted Mitchell Brothers at? Just out of curiosity.
It was more the Bashing Brothers. Brothers. That's where Smashing Brothers originates from. And with me shouting Smash them and Rabu shouting Brothers, it was like stolen from beer money. So okay. It was things that just clicked, and it was things to get us initially out there. Obviously, we've now changed to Casino Brutale, which I prefer much more. But Smashing Brothers will always have a wee place in my heart. But it was one of the things, that name and us being named, we didn't want to just be the bald, angry guys forever. So we're kind of trying to, character development, but kind of bring it up a wee bit so that we're not just... Obviously,
there's some depth to the character, and you can actually do some other things than I do. Bald guys that just smash folk. There's a little bit of there's a page two to the character kind of thing. So how did this tag team come about then? So is from what I remember, Rabu was popping up in ICW as a referee, and then suddenly you guys were a tag team. So how did this who put these together and how did you get
straight together? And we're friends and stuff like that. And everyone always said, yous will be great as a team. And we get put together a couple of times as tag teams and stuff like that, like as heels. We've done it as good guys as well. And training, it's been a bit weird being trying to be the good guy. We've done it both. So, and it was one of the ones where it was, this is going to work. It is working. We are a good match for each other. Both been bald. Instantaneous heat. It's brilliant.
That seems to be a pattern in this blog. I don't know if I'm just going to call it the bald cast because like I say, anything I say about it, it's I can't judge. But when it came to the tag team stuff, you mentioned beer money doing the kind of Smashing Brothers bit and the Bashing Brothers, of course. Was there any other tag teams that you took inspiration from? I mean, initially, just from looking at you, I don't know why. What's called now FTR. FTR pops to mind just because Dax Harwood's bald. So was there any tag teams that you and Rabu watched or you yourself watched and wanted to take some inspiration from?
Uh, Not really.
I think a tag team would be about when you started watching in 2000s and what have you. That other than of course Basham's was 2003. So tag team times world's greatest tag team, maybe Team Angle.
World's greatest. That's a good shout. Don't want to say that, please. Because. Well, nothing like them. Well, nothing like them.
Which one's Devon? I mean, that's what
well, probably me. Probably me. Who gets pinned the most out of the two of them? And that would be me.
Yeah, I would be Devon then, I think. Do my sums. When they did get pinned. Okay, fair enough. So nothing in particular, just kind of things picked up along the way.
We were two singles wrestlers who were obviously going to become a tag team at some point, and now it's a thing. I thoroughly enjoy doing the tag team stuff. Growing up, I never thought I'd be a tag team wrestler, but I seem to love doing tag team matches a lot more now than singles matches. I just feel like this it opens up so much. You can get more kind of creative for tag team matches than what you can with just a bare singles match.
With tag team matches, it's like half the work physically, but it's double the work mentally because you've got two other folk to plot around and get everything in. And I never knew there was that many rules until I was in one of those Looking Sharp seminars. There was one with Krieger and it was free. So I was like, well, jump into that, have a wee listen. And he was going about things, tag team rules and that. I was like, I didn't realise there was so much to this. And then I watched the tag match that same night and I was like, oh, there is so much rules to this that I didn't realise that there was.
There is so much you need to think about. Obviously, the five count, holding the rope. I'm terrible for that. I'm terrible for that, no holding the rope. And obviously, keeping away from the opposite corner. I'm terrible. I was terrible for getting too close to the opposite corner and stuff like that. So a lot does go into it. But as I said, I really enjoy it and I enjoy the creative side towards them.
It's definitely an advantage that you got guys like BT, of course, who's a long-running tag team with Steve Boy Xavier, who joined GPWA not long ago. And you've got Liam Thompson. Around about there now coming in, so there's definitely guys that have done the tag team scene to near perfection.
Yep.
They're able to pick their brains and get stuff from them. From like outside of the matches you've actually had, has there been any wrestlers that you've done seminars with, like a Chick Cullen, that you've been maybe even surprised that you've taken so much away from, or was there any particular seminar that you were just you came out with so much that it was like left a big impression on you?
After the Chick Cullen seminar at Reckless, I done the Paul Tracy seminar the following month, and I was in the Reckless Rumble that night as well. That like, all the stuff like kind of he was teaching on the holds and stuff like that, just like, chain. And kind of submission moves and just the movements and stuff like that, taking all that, and that was probably one of my favourite seminars that I'd been to.
Suppose that kind of takes your worlds, your amateur wrestling you did, and then your professional wrestling, but that kind of just it's like a perfect melting pot of everything that you kind of want in one class.
Yep. It was a good class. Also hold, probably couldn't remember half of them because there were so many and it was just over my head.
Something gets in, yeah.
Something will stick. I'll remember something. I was just probably just enjoying myself too much.
So before, of course, you said Purge was your last match before lockdown. And all that good stuff happened, last year.
Yeah.
Stuff that nobody really wants to remember, but kind of have to for some reason or another. big layoff. Was it 18 months between your return? What did you do? What was your? Did you just enjoy your time with your daughter and on the back burner?
I maintained myself, so I didn't go too far with the binge eating and stuff like that, and I didn't overdo it with the workouts and stuff. I just kind of maintained, and then to the end of last year, I was like, right, I'm going to get myself together, and I did for a wee bit, and then I fell off the boat again, and I was back to being a vest wrestler for my match just there at CPW. So now it's for going towards the end of the year, it's to get myself back to not being a vest wrestler.
It's one of those things, though, because when you see some wrestlers come back, there's people that have just remained the same, or like there's maybe a little jiggle here and there, or something tightened up here and there, or they're humongous, which, you know, it's them. They'll get where they need to be or want to be with it, or they're absolutely ripped to the gills. You go, how did you do that? As I sit here, and I think I put on the pandemic 2 stone because I didn't have to walk anywhere other than with the dog. I just sat here. My bed is the other side of that wall. I don't even need to commute anymore. It's been a fun time. I've enjoyed it. My knees probably don't, if you keep at least maintaining yourself, it's the balance in the middle. It's a bit in the middle. So when you find out you're making a return then, community pro wrestling, of course, with Davey, who we've mentioned. When did you find out he had this plan for the show and you were on it?
I'd found out, I think, a month or so before hand. He'd asked me to be on it. I knew it was a tag match. And then also turned into the six-man. Because with myself, me, Rabu, and HT against Big Ross, Darrow, and Spider-Bam. And it was the first match. It was my first match back after so long. And it was the first match that my daughter and my stepson were there to see. And it was in front of the Govan crowd. I'd never been to a Govan show before that, so I'd only heard and only seen through videos how wild that crowd can be, and again, I went out and I was instantly getting booed, which was again easy, and I couldn't have asked probably for a better match to come back to, with the fact that Spider-Man was in the match. And I would look over the corner, and my daughter was absolutely losing her mind at the fact I'm getting battered off Spider-Man. So it was good. I thoroughly enjoyed it and I loved it. I couldn't have asked for a better match to have came back to.
The Govan crowd, I've only ever seen it through video, and it's a crowd. Wow, I was gonna say feral. I think that seems really cruel when I say that, but it is. It's just it's sugar. It's full of sugar and sweets and just excitement and a lot of swearing. So, what was your daughter and stepson's thought then? I mean, other than you getting battered off Spider-Man, which is amazing in itself, what was their reactions to you being the wrestler?
They loved it. That was my daughter's first wrestling show she'd been to. She loved it. My stepson as well. That was his first. Well, it wasn't his first one. I took him to a Bathgate Wrestle Experience Scotland show beforehand, and he loved that. So I knew we haven't come to see me. They loved that as well. My daughter loved it that much that I had to take her to the Wrestle Experience Scotland show that was on Saturday there, just because she loved it so much. And she was just losing her mind at things. It's nice to see. The bug. The bug is, she's caught it. definitely.
You know, sit her down before and go, you can't chant the things that we did at Govan. You can't say those things at this one. But no, that's why, I mean, that's why I like going to live shows. I mean, wrestling, I mean, nowadays is still not, as much as people want to say it is, it's still not the cool thing. And at our age, it might not be as cool to watch it and you think it's for kids. But when you go to shows and you see them just absolutely lose their minds at anything, and I'm just there going, I wish I could show that I'm that excited, but I'm still like self-conscious, but I'm feeling that excited just on the inside. It's so much fun to see people enjoy wrestling and to be back after 18 months and getting to see a Govan crowd, especially. So many people just excited to see people wrestle again. Was that a little bit emotional outside of obviously having your family there? Was it a bit emotional getting to hear a crowd again?
I went down with kind of jacket on, hood up, just kind of stood and watched the crowd for the first majority of the show. But I was on third, we were third match, and I just went down and watched the first couple of matches from the window, and it was the butterflies were back, and it was nice. It was a good feeling. Like I'd missed it that much. So it was good. It was good.
You don't realise how much you missed it until you see that first show again, do you? Because I was the same for being in the crowd. I didn't think I missed it, and then by the time the first match started, my wife was turning to me going, "Are you crying?" I went, "No, I'm not crying." I just looked emotional. I just looked happy to be there. She was like, "Are you sure you're not crying?" "I'm definitely not crying." Shush. If you ask me again, I might, but don't. But yeah, wrestling is just amazing. So in that time off then, 18 months, you said you're enjoying time with your family. What was your wrestling habits like then? Were you watching things? Were you catching up on things like AEW, watching pay-per-views?
Whenever I get control of the telly, I do like to watch the wrestling and stuff like that. I like watching older stuff as well. I recently went back and watched Brett and Sean Iron Man match because I love that, and then just like kind of because it's accessible, just going back through the old pay-per-views. One of my favourite matches is Kurt Angle versus Undertaker No Way Out 2006. Yep, that's one of my favourite matches and I love going back and watching that. I like watching Kurt Angle and Shane Street Fight.
Oh yeah.
That's a lot of that. Old ones that just pop into my head and go, "You've got to go watch that now."
I like to, like, when it's this time of year, as we're recording, it's November. November when this goes out, but it's Survivor Series time, so I like to just pick up some Survivor Series. I'll watch a couple of those. Royal Rumble time, I'll watch a couple of Royal Rumble shows, and WrestleMania, I'm the same. It's like going, oh, it's almost Survivor Series. Oh, remember that one from 2002? Oh, that's, I'm going to watch that then. I'm going to watch 2002 Survivor Series. I watched 2001 a couple of nights ago, and I don't care what anyone says. I loved Invasion, and that was just the whole Invasion angle. And just to see that, yeah, it was just so much fun. And like I say, so easily accessible. You can just
go back, go down, if you want to watch it. It's there.
Outside of that, was anything other outside of wrestling that's your thing? For me, it's, you may see the background Marvel stuff. Well, actually, kind of, because Marvel stuff.
I'm actually quite a boring person. I like my Xbox and my PlayStation and stuff like that. But I'll learn that. So that's about it. I'm just pure bland, boring.
It's always a worry when people ask that question, because I know for myself as well, if they go, "Oh, what do you like outside of wrestling?" I like the MCU. Anything else? No. Not a lot much after that. Yeah. So just, well, on our wrestling question from Manic Mania Fee on Twitter, she's asked, is there anyone you get nervous about facing in the ring?
No, not really.
Ravy Davey when he's grappling.
You just get excited. Like, the nerves won't help you. I'm just excited to be wrestling. Now that's the stage I'm at. Even when I had my my first match back there. I wasn't nervous, I was just excited to get out there. So it's nice to have that frame of mind now when I'm not, obviously, probably further in line if an opportunity comes up. I might, there might be times where I'm nervous in the future, but like the now and in the past, I've just been excited, if anything.
Have you got a bucket list at all of opponents, whether it's just in the UK or elsewhere? Have you got anyone that you want to try and get the ring with the next, I don't know, 5 years at all?
I've done a list a couple of years ago. I've done one of the start of the year.
The Cody Rhodes one ones.
I can't remember many people on it. But off the top of my head, BT Gunn, Stevie Boy, Ian Skinner, I'd like to wrestle him. Because you've asked me now.
I'll put you on the spot. Undertaker when he does the camps, you know.
Yes, of course. Definitely, see if he's available. I've already wrestled him, but Charlie Rice again, because he's fun to wrestle.
Well, there you go. You can get the Casino Brutale against Thatcher's Cabinet. I'll take two off there right away.
I'll just be who can get booed most.
When you say it like that, do we boo bald people or Tories? What's the? I don't know if the crowd can cope. I'm going to ask Robbie the same kind of questions when it comes to the tag team stuff. But was there a conscious decision behind going away from Smashing Brothers? You said it was too much like Bashing Brothers and going to Casino Brutale, other than getting that little edge to your own characters. Was there a reason for Casino Brutale in general for that, your tag team name?
Rabu had an idea for coming back, and it was like, we should kind of move away from being the vanilla or angry bad guys who smash people. I thought, and it was the kind of Casino Brutale idea came up, and it's just describing it to me and stuff. He obviously, when she speak to him, he'll be able to explain it in better detail than me, because I'm a nightmare. But it was why I once I was like, you know what, you're right. We need to move away from that kind of just being good generic bad guy. And that was the kind of, oh, right, we'll do it. And in the works of getting new ring gear and stuff like that. So it's exciting, and I'm excited to see.
It's like your opponents take a gamble getting in the ring with you.
Yep.
There you go. It's all coming together. Right, so I asked two ridiculous questions to all of our guests, so unfortunately you're going to have to answer them too. They're not wrestling related in the slightest, they're just ridiculous questions. So the first one is, what's your favourite dinosaur?
Raptor.
Nice classic choice. And
yeah, to be specific, it would be Blue the Raptor. If we had to be
cool. That's fine. A bit of Jurassic World. And the other one we ask is, what would win in a fight, two sheep or one cow?
All right.
Stupid questions, but
I'm gonna have to go with the two sheep, I think. And the numbers game. The cows when they eventually get tired, don't it?
I agree. I'm always two sheep, but this question came about when I interviewed Looking Sharp, and Krieger asked it. That was the question he sent in, and I've asked it since. And it's just one of those questions that you'll either overthink it or just pick an answer and then go and just move on, because it's just a stupid question. But otherwise, or you'll sit here and just think, ah, but what if it's this kind of cow, or what if it's this kind of sheep? What if the sheep are in tandem? What if it's a female cow? What if it's a male? You can spoil yourself in that question if you need to. But no, I'm in agreement. Two sheep. I'm not going to argue with it. So like I said, your bucket list is, you just want to wrestle coaches and everyone. That's very much is there any companies that you want to try and get to? I noticed you're retweeting things like Discovery and what have you. But is there any companies that you're like, I want to get to there?
Those Discovery tag belts, look very nice. With the bucket list of wrestlers, I'd just like to wrestle. I picked a few names off the top of my head, but I'd like to just wrestle everyone. And where I would like to wrestle, I'd just like to wrestle everywhere and anywhere that will take a chance on me. I'm willing to travel and stuff like that. So just need to see what happens. Bye.
I'm starting to end these interviews. I'm trying to start when I remember to actually ask it with your dream match. So the dream match is your main event of WrestleMania or wherever AEW's all in. You get the last match. You get to pick your opponent. So it could be anyone, past, present. I would like maybe if they were active wrestling, but you know, Undertaker could come out of retirement. If you could pick anyone to face main event in WrestleMania, who is it?
Edge.
Nice choice. Cool. That's fine.
I didn't try to think about that one too much because it just ended up a 30-man rumble. And
that's fine. That's fine. I remember I got a question one of my other ones that I did, and it was dream match card of Scottish wrestlers, and pretty much I mentioned 7 matches, and I had so many names I just went. Rumble, it's the last one. Everyone I haven't mentioned, you're in the Rumble. That's where you are. That's fine. That's best. Everyone's happy. But no, that's great. Thanks for taking the time to speak to us. So before we go, though, the last thing's always your socials. How can people get in touch with you? How can people find out more about Mikey Devine?
Instagram. My Instagram is Mikey Devine 1. The same again for my Twitter. And it's just Mikey Devine, GPW on Facebook.
Perfect. Great. Well, thank you very much for joining me there.
Thank you very much, Colin.